When managing a patient in cardiac arrest, in addition to CPR, defibrillation, and vasoactive medications, you should be reviewing the potentially reversible causes of their cardiac arrest and acting to correct these if they are suspected. These causes are easy to remember and could potentially be life-saving for the patient. We'll call these reversible causes the H's and T's. So let's talk about them in more detail. Hypovolemia is a common cause of cardiac arrest, which can occur as a result from excessive fluid or blood loss. This results in decreased amount of fluid volume in the circulatory system, leading to decreases in tissue and organ perfusion. Examples of this include excessive amounts of diarrhea and/or vomiting, bleeding from traumas, volume loss from severe burns, etc. After starting CPR, the most important intervention is obtaining some sort of circulatory access, whether it's an IV or an IO. Subsequently, a fluid bolus should be given if you suspect hypovolemia, and in traumatic causes, blood and blood products can be considered. Hypoxia is a lack of adequate oxygenation to your organs and tissues. Because your respiratory system is a major determinant of oxygenation, you should pay close attention to your patient's airway and breathing. Make sure your patient is protecting their airway and that it is patent. Make sure that they are breathing and have bilateral breath sounds during respirations. Oxygen saturation measured by a pulse oximeter can also help in determining a patient's oxygenation. If needed, oxygen may be administered to the patient, and if the patient is not protecting their airway or not breathing adequately, further interventions such as BiPAP or endotracheal intubation may be considered. Remember that acidosis can be either metabolic or respiratory. Obtaining a blood gas is a quick way to determine if a patient is acidotic. In general, a pH less than 7.35 is considered acidotic. If a patient's process is a respiratory acidosis, ensure that they have adequate ventilation. If the process is a metabolic acidosis, you may administer sodium bicarbonate. Potassium is an important electrolyte which plays a role in maintaining normal electrical conduction and contraction of the heart. If levels become too high or too low, a patient may go into cardiac arrest. There are many causes of hypo and hyperkalemia, but regardless, it must eventually be determined to definitively treat your patient. However, in the emergent setting, certain medications should be considered. Hypokalemia is defined by a potassium level of less than 3.5 milliequivalents per liter, but you will begin to see EKG changes at levels less than 2.7. So, in the setting of hypokalemia, on an EKG you may see flattened or inverted T waves and prominent U waves. You could even see a prolongation of the PR interval. If you suspect hypokalemia, giving potassium quickly is important. With hyperkalemia, it is defined by a potassium level of greater than 5.5 milliequivalents per liter. At these levels, you will begin to see the earliest signs of repolarization abnormalities, like peak T waves. At levels greater than 6.5, you will start to see flattening of the P waves and a widening of the QRS complex. You could treat this initially with calcium, which will stabilize the cardiac membrane and should be the first medication given in the immediate setting. Other medications such as insulin and glucose, sodium bicarb, and furosemide can be considered but take longer to work. And ultimately, these patients may require hemodialysis. Hypothermia is defined as a core temperature below 35 degrees Celsius. Now, a person should never be declared dead unless they're warm and dead. When the body's core temperature drops below 30 degrees Celsius, cardiac output is decreased, which can lead to cardiac arrest. The body may not respond to CPR and defibrillation during these hypothermic states, so rewarming should be started. Things like passive external rewarming with warm blankets or active internal rewarming with warm IV fluids. A tension pneumothorax occurs when there is air in the pleural space. With enough air in this space, a shift in the mediastinum can occur, which can compress the blood vessels leading back to the heart. As a result, preload is decreased, leading to a decrease in cardiac output, which can lead to cardiac arrest. Patients may have decreased breath sounds on the side of the pneumothorax, and there may be tracheal deviation away from the side of the pneumothorax. As a result, these patients can have difficulty in ventilation, and you may even see evidence of a pneumothorax on a bedside ultrasound. You'll treat the pneumothorax by needle decompression and the insertion of a chest tube. Cardiac tamponade occurs when fluid or blood fills the pericardium surrounding the heart. The fluid constricts the heart and prevents the ventricles from filling properly. Like pneumothoraces, this decreased filling is called preload, leading to a decrease in cardiac output. Causes of tamponade include penetrating trauma to the chest, such as a stab wound or gunshot wound, or may be caused by inflammation, among other things. You can visualize cardiac tamponade by using a bedside ultrasound, and if found, a pericardiocentesis or thoracotomy is needed to remove the fluid. Toxins, or an overdose of certain medications or illicit drugs, can lead to cardiac arrest. Information of what was found at the scene by EMS upon arrival is important because it can lead to the potential intoxicant. EKGs are also important to obtain given that some of these drugs can cause cardiac arrest by augmenting cardiac intervals. In addition to supportive care, a reversal agent or antidote may be administered if you have a strong suspicion for a particular toxin. A pulmonary embolism can lead to cardiac arrest, especially if they are massive. Large PEs obstruct right ventricular output, leading to decreased cardiac output and arrest. History is important if it can be obtained from a family or friend, because prior to arrest, the patient may have had signs and symptoms of shortness of breath, chest pain, and decreased oxygen levels. They may even have presented with a cough. If an EKG is obtained prior to the arrest, it will most commonly show signs of sinus tachycardia. Treatment is usually embolectomy, fibrinolytic therapies, and anticoagulant therapy. A coronary thrombosis is a blockage within the coronary arteries, leading to a myocardial infarction or ischemia. The occlusion of the coronary artery prevents blood flow to the heart, and as a result, the heart muscle dies. Cardiac arrest can occur depending on the location and the extent of the blockage and ischemia. History is also important if it can be obtained, most likely from a friend or family, because the patient may have complained of severe substernal chest pain before losing consciousness. If an EKG can be obtained, ST elevations may be present. In the acute setting, fibrinolytic therapy can be considered, but the definitive treatment includes angioplasty and stent placement, or CABG.